How's it going? Good. You guys are the faithful people because, like, you know, it's gorgeous out and it's the final round of the Masters and you came to church. I love that. I did too, and grateful to be in God's house. You know, this video, like every time, because it's just 2 weeks now, but when this video plays, it's like this peaceful music and these nice little birds singing and things like that. And it's like with that combined with the really nice weather outside, it just like has me thinking about like vacation. This is like the time every year, right about now, is when I look at my calendar and go, oh no, I haven't actually planned when I'm gonna be gone. And you know, you start looking on like hotels and stuff like that, and that's booked, that's booked. And so I hope you have some things planned even this summer to get some time of rest and relaxation. I love getting to go to new places, you know, getting to travel places, have new experiences, be in new places, see new things, try new foods, come on. Like that's like so much fun for me. But I think as I've gotten a little bit older, I've found myself missing home more and more. When I'm gone, you know, you're gone for a couple days and like the first couple days you love that. And then you start just, I just start kind of missing home a little bit. I miss my home. I miss my family. I miss my little fluffy dog. I miss my bed. That's like a new thing for me. I think, you know, like, I feel like I'm far away from it, but I can just hear it calling to me. And it's like this, it's such a strange thing. When I was a kid, I never would have thought that I would have like missed my bed. But that's like a thing. And I think part of that is because the feeling of like belonging and comfort and like, this is my place. This is like where I belong. And so that happens to us sometimes when we're traveling and we're far from home, but we have that like a little bit of a homesick, a little bit of a, I want to be kind of where I belong at my place. And we're talking about First Peter. We're going through this series, Strangers in a Strange Land. And last week we talked about being exiles. And so much of what Peter is talking about is that concept of having a little bit of like a homesickness. And then what do we do while we're here and we're feeling that homesickness, that belief that like I actually belong somewhere else. We're going to look at that hope that we have that's resting for us in all eternity because of Jesus Christ. And just before we do that, let's take a moment and pray. Father, we're grateful for your word and grateful for a day to gather. We thank you that your mercies are new every morning. It's easier for us to remember that and feel that on beautiful days like this, but whatever the day holds, we pray that we would give you praise for it. God, we would pray that you would open our eyes even now by your Holy Spirit. Would you move in this room, in this place to illumine the pages of your scripture to us so that we could love you more and live in a way that honors you more in this world as we await another. We pray this in Jesus' name, amen. So hopefully you have your Bible open to 1 Peter. If not, there's Bibles all around. There's, a, you know, if you're new, no hard feelings. There's a table of contents at the beginning, like just, you know. But 1 Peter is towards the end of the Bible in the New Testament. And we're walking through this series. So we're in 1 Peter 1, verses 3 through 12 today. And we're talking about this idea of living hope, the living hope that we have. My Bible actually has that as a little heading there, born again to a living hope. We sang that song a moment ago. This is the passage where that song actually comes from. We're going to see three things today about our hope. First, our hope is secure, so worship. And second, our hope outweighs any suffering that we could ever experience, so rejoice. And then finally, our hope was promised. So remember, first, our hope is secure. Let's start reading with me 1 Peter 1, 3 through 5 first. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you, who by God's power are being guarded through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. So last week we looked at Peter's greeting. It's just a couple of verses where he's telling us that we are elect exiles. We're chosen by God before the foundation of the world and created as made into new creations because of Jesus Christ. But we're away from our home right now. We're exiles in a strange land. That our home is in heaven, our inheritance and our hope is in heaven with Jesus Christ for all of eternity, but we're not there yet. We're here on this world. And then here, Peter is getting into sort of the bulk of his letter, and he begins this by calling us to worship. He says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. We're to worship God. He's moved past his greeting. Now we're into it, and he begins with worship. What is his reason for us to worship the Lord? Notice he says, it's because of his great mercy in us, because God has placed his incredible mercy upon us, and he's done what with that? He's made us born again, that we have a new spiritual life that God has given us, given his people, because of what Jesus has done on the cross. Scripture would say that you and I, we are dead in our trespasses and sins, unable to accomplish anything of worth on our own, dead. And yet Jesus Christ makes us alive. That's why Peter and so many writers use this terminology of born again, that we've been born again to a new spiritual life because of what Jesus has done and our faith in him. And then it says that we have a living hope. Hope is a confident expectation of what is to come for us in Jesus Christ. A confident expectation of what is to come for us in Jesus Christ. It's not the way that we would use the word hope. Oh, I really hope this will happen. I really hope that the Blackhawks will have a better season next year. They are terrible this year. Tom gives me an amen for that. I mean, like, come on, guys, get it together. You know, like a peewee team could beat you. But that's where we're at right now. But it's not like I hope we'll get another good draft pick and have a great season next year. That's not what it's talking about, because that's not secure. That's not confident there. We're to have a confident expectation. Your hope has already been accomplished for you. It's secure in heaven. Because of what Jesus Christ has done, you have it. It is yours. Peter calls it an inheritance. And notice here, he calls our hope then a living hope. Why would he say that our hope is a living hope? Two things, both in the text. Look at the text. First, notice, what is it that brings about the hope that you and I have? It's Jesus' resurrection. Easter Sunday makes your hope living. He's alive, and therefore our hope is a living one. That's why our hope is living. And then second, also in the text, our hope is living in that it grows and increases in our as our lives as believers continue to grow. Much like a plant or a tree, it starts off small, but as it continues to grow, it increases. So too for the believer, the one who follows Jesus Christ, the longer you've been following the Lord, your hope for what is to come should be increasing because it's secure. Sometimes in waiting for something, we allow our hope and our expectation to actually diminish. I've been unemployed for so long and been looking for a job and time after time can't find something. Is it ever going to happen? We allow our expectation to diminish in that way. I've been struggling with this health concern for so long and doctor visit after doctor visit and medication after medication. And I just, is it ever even going to happen, or is this just what it's like? We allow our expectations to diminish then because we've been waiting for so long. Proverbs 13:12 even says, hope deferred makes the heart sick. That sometimes when you're waiting so long for something, our hearts can become sick because of that, and we end up losing hope even. Paul would say in 2 Corinthians 4, though, he would call us and he would say, so we do not lose heart. We don't lose hope. Our hope doesn't diminish in all of this. Instead, it increases. But he says, we do not lose heart, though our outer self is wasting away. Things are just falling apart around here. But our inner self is being renewed day by day. It's continuing every day. And then he says, for this light momentary affliction is preparing for us an eternal weight of glory beyond all comparison. That as we look to the things that are not, that are seen, but to the things that are not, that are unseen. For the things that are unseen, the things that are seen are transient, but the things that are unseen are eternal. We're looking to those things, increasing in our hope because it's a living hope. So for those of us who have followed Jesus Christ for a while, our hope for what is awaiting us in all eternity should be increasing. We should be more and more homesick the longer we follow Jesus and the more we look forward to what awaits us. The more that we live in this strange land, the more we long for our home. The more we're here, the more homesick we become. And we long for our home. We can be sure that it's there. Peter calls it our inheritance, that it's something that's secure for us. Just like the inheritance of a family who leaves a wealthy inheritance to a child. They don't have access to any of those funds while they're still a child, but it still belongs to them. The kid is still loaded, even though it's not fully theirs yet. And that's the imagery that Peter gives us here. His Jewish readers, of course, would have immediately thought of the land of Israel, a physical inheritance that the people of Israel had. This land that throughout their history, there's hundreds of years that they're not actually in the land that is promised to them. We see it as the promised land. And even as they're away, they're longing for this home, this inheritance that they have. And God made a promise to the people of Israel and said, it's yours forever, even when you don't live there. It is your inheritance. It's secure. And that's what Peter is telling us here. He's saying that God's people, we have an eternal inheritance, just as the Jewish people had a physical inheritance in the land of Israel. Heaven is yours because Jesus was raised from the dead. It's yours. It's your inheritance. Through faith in him, you're heirs of that inheritance, and it is waiting for you no matter what. It's secure. Nothing can change that. It's been promised by God, and God always keeps his promises. Notice how Peter here describes this inheritance. He says these words, it's imperishable, it's undefiled, it's unfading, and it's kept for you. It won't ever die or spoil through any of the difficulties of this life. It won't ever be ruined by any failure you could ever have. It won't ever fade or tarnish at all by any actions of others against you. Nothing you could do or that could be done to you, no circumstance could ever cause you to be anything other than kept, held secure. That's what it means. It's a completed past action. We already took care of that. Jesus Christ took it and put it in a lockbox with under lock and key and holds that key, and nothing can change that for you if you're in Jesus Christ. If you have turned from your sins and believed in Jesus' death and resurrection for your salvation, for the cleansing of your soul, you are secure. You're held secure by all of that. Notice he also says, who by God's power are being guarded. This is such an encouragement to me because it's not just your inheritance that's kept. You're kept for your inheritance. Oh, we might think like, yeah, I know it's over there, but what about all the mess that's happening right now? No, you're kept too. You're being guarded by God's power. You are kept safe. Your hope is carefully watched over, and you are held secure by a merciful and powerful God. Jesus reminds us of this same thing in John 10, 27. He says, "My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they will never perish. No one will snatch them out of my hand. And my Father who's given them to me is greater than all, and no one will snatch them out of my Father's hand." Your hope is secure. It is held firmly by Jesus's hand and held firmly by the grasp of the Father. Nothing can ever change that. So we worship him because of that. That's why Peter begins this by saying, "Blessed be God, because I'm held secure, and the hope that I have in Jesus Christ, it's fixed firmly and nothing can change that." We just sang and worshiped, "Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You've broken every chain. There's salvation in your name. Jesus Christ, my living hope." That's what Peter's talking about. Your hope will be revealed at the end, and in the meantime, it is completely secure. So worship the Lord in this strange land as you wait for your secure hope to be revealed. Secondly, our hope outweighs our suffering. Rejoice. Let's continue reading verse 6 of 1 Peter 1. "In this you rejoice, though now for a little while, if necessary, you've been grieved by various trials, so that the tested genuineness of your faith, more precious than gold that perishes, though it is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. Though you have not seen him, you love him. And though you do not now see him, you believe in him and rejoice with joy that is inexpressible and filled with glory, obtaining the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls." He's saying, in this you rejoice, in the hope and the salvation, in the security, in the inheritance that we have. Rejoice in that. And it's not the idea of just sort of like, why don't you just be happy? You should just look on the bright side. Pretend that nothing bad is happening and just sweep everything under the rug and pretend everything is great and just put on a smile. That's not at all what he's saying. The idea is rejoice even though you're suffering. It's not even after the suffering necessarily. It's like even though you're suffering, still rejoice. Because for the believer, our grief, our pain, our suffering has a purpose. We may not always realize what that purpose is. You may not realize the specific thing that God is doing in your life and how he's working it for good, but we can be sure that he is working. We can be sure that it is going to be for our good. Peter would say here that God is testing us by fire. As the precious metal heated up and the impurities come and the dross is skimmed off the top so that a more beautiful product is there, Peter's using that analogy to tell us that's what it's like when these trials, these necessary trials that we're grieved by, that's what it's doing. And isn't that true of us, that when things are difficult, that's when the garbage comes out? I have never caught my belt loop on a door handle except when I'm frustrated. Does this happen to you? You're like frustrated walking through the house and you're like, "Whoa, stupid door." That has never happened to me when I'm just like, never once. It's only when things are difficult. They're not here today. They're with my dad. But I have never yelled at my kids when everything is happy and going fine. Oh, I have when I'm like overly stressed and had to apologize to them afterwards. When the difficult things happen, sometimes the awful stuff comes out. Sometimes you're having a heated conversation with a loved one, and in the middle of that conversation, like, the words are coming out of your mouth, and then I realize just how selfish of a person I am. It's like in the difficulties, that's when all of that garbage comes out. That needs to be out of my heart. And God is using the difficulties to root some of those things out. Sometimes we see it. Most of the time, we never see it. But God is using those uncomfortable things. Sometimes those uncomfortable things in life are the very things that grow us. A smooth sea was never making a skilled sailor. And Peter here says that these things are happening for a little while, that if necessary, in this you rejoice, though now for a little while. And some of you are going through a trial that you've been waiting for a long time. And you read a line like that and you're like, in a little while? I have been waiting. So this is not a little while. Peter does not have any clue what a little while is. But that's what he says, that this is just a little while that we're struggling with these things. And if you're going through a long season of trial and of pain and of suffering, I first just want to say I'm so sorry. It's difficult. And I may not know at all what you're going through, but God sees every ounce of it. He sees everything that's happening, all of the pain, all of the weight that you are carrying every single day. And I understand that it's difficult. And I may not understand, the people around you may not really know exactly what you're going through, but God sees all of it. And although I may not know exactly what you are going through, I do know the pain of being in a very long trial and feeling like and asking God, is this ever going to change? Or is this just my life now? And that's what Peter's little while is meant to be, an encouragement to us, because his point is that in comparison to our living hope, in comparison to eternity that is waiting for us, the sufferings that we are experiencing right now are so fleeting. It's just a little while. Paul called it this light momentary affliction. And when you're in the middle of that, it doesn't feel light and it doesn't feel momentary. It does not feel at all like a little while. It feels like forever. But in the grand scheme of eternity, because of the hope that's awaiting us, it's so much greater than any trials that we could ever experience. And Peter here is saying, have a view of eternity, that eternity's long and life is short and our trials within it are, it's just a little while and then it's over. But notice, Peter doesn't say that we're to rejoice when the trials are over. It's not that we've seen God answer our prayers, that we've been in a season of trial, of pain, of heartache, and we've been in a dark season of suffering, and we've leaned on the Lord, and we've seen him give us peace and strength and comfort, and then God brought me through all of those things, and he answered my prayer, and now I rejoice. I mean, that's amazing, and that does happen, and if you're in that season and you've seen the Lord bring you through a season of trial and onto the other side, you should be rejoicing through it. You should be praising the Lord through it. Amen for that. But that's not at all what Peter is saying here. He's saying rejoice in the middle of the trial. He's not saying when you've wiped the tears from your eyes, now rejoice. He's saying rejoice while they are still running down your eyes. Like, while you are still in the middle of lament, still rejoice. And I gotta say, this was a hard thing for me to figure out. Like, how do I really rejoice while I'm weeping? Oh, I know the, like, rejoicing afterwards. I know the, like, God, you're amazing. Thank you for answered prayer. I'm rejoicing because it was so hard and now it's not anymore, but how do I rejoice in the middle of it? As you are going through it, rejoice. I wrote down three things that I have learned. Hopefully they can be somewhat helpful to you. How do I rejoice in the trial? First, worship no matter what. Getting your heart to the place where you may not understand what's happening and you may not understand why any of these things happen, but I will worship you just the same, God. You are good and you are powerful and you are working and you are worthy. And so I will take any good things that I have and any mess and brokenness, and I will bring it all in broken arms to the altar and dump it before Jesus Christ and fall to my knees and say, you are worthy, Lord. I will worship you no matter what. Getting to that place where you will worship no matter what will fuel your rejoicing. How do I rejoice in the trial? Worship no matter what. And then second, bring my trial to the Lord. I am the worst about, like, I'm gonna go try to fix this. If I talk to this person, if I just do this, I can sort it out. I got it. Take your trial, take your heartache and come to the Lord. Lord, I don't know what to do, but my eyes are on you. Lord, please answer here. Please work. Please show me what to do. Please give me wisdom in this trial. Bring your trial to the Lord. So often we would take our trial and we would go hide and we would be pushed away from the Lord and like, God's angry with me and I can't believe all of this that happened. No. Worship the Lord and bring your trial before the Lord. And then thirdly, trust the Lord and believe he's using it. I'm going to worship him in the middle of it, no matter what. I'm going to bring my trial to the Lord. This thing that is so painful and so is such a heartache for me, God, I'm bringing it to you. Please use it somehow. And then trust the Lord. Trust his goodness. Trust that he's working and believe that he's using it. Because the answer for how do I rejoice in the trial, it's not found in the trial itself. It's not found in the resolution to the trial. It's not found in whatever the answer to that will be, the conclusion of my trial. The answer to rejoicing, the joy, is only found in the one who's controlling your trial, who holds all of it, who's watching over it all and using all of it, the good and the pain and the heartache and the brokenness and all of it. That is the only place where true joy is found. So get my eyes off of my suffering as much as possible and on to the Lord. Now, that's not to say, I said it a minute ago, that's not to say sort of like, I'm just going to pretend that my pain's not here under the, I'm happy, I'm rejoicing. It's not to say ignore it. You have to grieve the pain too. It's not pretend that it's not there. You need to accept the pain and really feel it, honestly. And that hurts. You need to weep over it. But constantly staring at the pain and the wound is not going to make it easier. It's going to make it worse. It's like any kid who's learning to skateboard and they're learning to ollie and they fall off their skateboard and they skin their knee. It's like anyone who's been a parent or hung around kids when they get injured knows that moment when they like fall and skin their knee and there's the breath and there's a little bit of silence. And as a parent, you're like, what we got? What's good? Are you okay? You know, like with my first kid, with Judah, you're like, this is a bad idea. You don't react that way. The best way is just to kind of like, what's going to happen? Because what's happened so often is like a kid falls and they're like, ooh, and they get right back up and go. But so often that kid falls off of the skateboard and skins their knee and there's the breath. And then they'll look down at the wound. Ah! And it's amazing the pain that comes after I'm staring at the wound. And I think so often in our lives when we're going through a season of trial, we're like, God, look at my knee, look at the blood, and there's so much blood, and I don't know if it's ever going to heal, and what is it going to be like? Am I ever going to skateboard again? And get your eyes off the skint knee and onto the one who has control over all of it. Because staring at the knee is not going to make it better. Staring at the knee over and over and over and reminding myself of the pain that I'm feeling. Listen, you're going to feel the pain either way. But staring at it and dwelling on it rather than looking to the Lord is going to make it worse. So come to the Father with your skinned knee and all of the things in life that are way worse than a skinned knee. But come to the Father with your skinned knee and fall into his arms and cry for the hurt that you're experiencing and the pain that you're feeling that is real, and then trust that he's going to make everything good in his time. Now, it might not be on this side of eternity even, but he'll work it for our good. One of the things that's been really helpful for me in seasons of trial and seasons of waiting, you know, you spend so much time praying, and sometimes I just get on my knees and I'm like, I don't even know what else, what could I say that I haven't said 1,000 times? I don't even know what else to pray. And one of the things that's been helpful for me are like devotionals or written prayers, to read some of those to stir my heart. One that I love is called Every Moment Holy. There's, I think they have 3 volumes. They have all sorts of stuff. There's like, no, I'm not exaggerating. There's like little prayers about like when making a cup of coffee, when the kids are being disobedient. When there's like all of these little prayers. It's a really, really good volume. There's 3 of them, but the volume 2 is all about grief and loss and hurt and heartache. And one of the prayers is called Upon Feeling a Stab of Grief. And if you've been walking through a long trial, you know that in and of itself, just that title is so true to what it really is. That you're sort of going about life, and I think I'm okay. And then just see something, or maybe just your mind wanders, and it's just like, ow, it hurts again, you know? But this prayer that was written is, I think, so helpful along these lines. The prayer reads, Let me learn, pang by pang, O Lord, how these hurts, while they will never in this life completely cease, might serve like stitchings, binding me ever tighter to eternal hope. Lord, let the difficult things in this life be like stitchings to bind me closer to the secure living hope that I have in Jesus Christ, knowing that this pain in this world will never be completely gone, that I will never be without suffering or be without trials in this world. So let all of these things bind my heart to you, Jesus, through all of it. So allow the hurts to grow your hope in him and trust that somehow it's necessary for your growth. That's what Peter says here. For a little while, if necessary, you've been grieved by various trials so that the tested genuineness of your faith may be found to result in praise and glory and honor. A passage that I've shared several times, it's one of my favorites, is James 1, where he says, Count it all joy when you meet trials of various kinds. Why? Why are we supposed to rejoice in the trial? James would say, because you know that the testing of your faith, it produces steadfastness, and let steadfastness have its full effect, that you would be perfect, complete, lacking in nothing, trusting that God is using the hurt, the pain, the skinned knee, so that I'm growing in Jesus Christ. Peter means the same thing when he says that our genuine tested faith is more precious than gold. And James would continue in 1:12, blessed is the one who remains steadfast under the trial, for when he has stood the test, he will receive the crown of life. It's secure for you because it's your living hope, and God has promised to those who love him. Listen, God's promises in your suffering and your pain may not be revealed this week or this month or this year or maybe even not in this lifetime. But someday, Jesus will return and all things will be brought to light. All of God's purposes will be clear to us, and maybe in the deepest way possible, the trust in God becomes more precious, like gold, when things don't make sense, when we don't have an answer, when we don't see any of that. But I think it would leave us to in the place where we're sort of asking, so, well, what about now? Like, what do I actually have now? I know I have a hope for the future. I can look forward to that, but what do I have right now? Well, notice what Peter says here in verse 8, though you have not seen him, you love him. What he's calling us to is a deep relationship with Jesus, even though we've never seen him. We haven't seen Jesus face to face. Peter's readers wouldn't have, but Peter had. But he's saying, listen, even though you haven't seen him, you love him. And here, Peter's calling us to rejoice again, not just because of what's to come, but also because of what you have right now. He's calling us to rejoice in increasing ways because we know Jesus. In Jesus, you have eternal life. You have that life that's secured for you, the hope that you have for all of eternity. You have eternal life, but you also have abundant life. And that's what Peter is talking about here. He's talking about the daily joy of walking closely with Jesus. Because when you're in the middle of the trial, you want somebody to fix it. We often think, like, if I could talk to the right person, if I could just sit down and get some sound advice from a seasoned counselor, if I could just change some of the circumstances, maybe if I could have a heart-to-heart conversation with this person, if I could maybe find the right book to read, that would help. If I could just take a little bit of time off, get a vacation, if I could just, and we keep throwing those words in there, if I could just blank. And some of those things are actually really good things to do. Maybe they would be good for you in the season of trial to read a good book or something like that. But none of those, if I could just, will ever really produce what you really need in the middle of a storm. We want the quick fix. We want the simple solution. And the fix is never quick. The solution is quite simple, though, and it's right here in this text. What does Peter say? Though you have not seen him, you love him. Though you do not now see him, you believe and rejoice. The thing that you need in the middle of a trial is a greater love for Jesus. And that sounds like, oh yeah, that's the Sunday school answer. That's what you're supposed to say. You're the pastor. I'm sitting in church. But Peter says that's what we need more than anything else. We need a greater, deeper intimacy with Jesus Christ. That is what you need in the season of trial. You and I need a greater trust in Jesus and all of his plans. You and I need to rejoice in him and what he's doing, even when we don't get it at all. I didn't say that it would be easy, but it is quite simple what we're called to do. And there will be days when you just want to fix it all right now. But believing and trusting his plans means that you open your hands and release whatever happens to a loving and powerful Savior. There will be nights when you just want to scream because of the pain and the heartache. But loving him deeper in the trial might mean that you slip out of bed awkwardly in the dark and drop to your knees in the dark and weep in prayer before a loving and powerful Savior who's there in the midst of it. Because it's on your knees that you will learn to rejoice in the hope that you have in Jesus alone. The hope that's waiting for us. It's greater than all of our trials, so we rejoice. And finally, our hope was promised. Remember. Let's finish reading our text, 1 Peter 1, 10 through 12 now. Concerning this salvation, the hope that we've been talking about, the prophets who prophesied about the grace that was to be yours searched and inquired carefully, inquiring what person or time the Spirit of Christ in them was indicating when he predicted the sufferings of Christ and the subsequent glories. Notice the sufferings of Jesus were predicted, and also the glories of Jesus were predicted. It was revealed to them that they were serving not themselves, but you in the things that have now been announced to you through those who preach the good news to you by the Holy Spirit sent from heaven, things into which angels long to look. And what he's saying here is that we have a promised hope, and that hope that we've experienced in Jesus Christ, the message of the gospel, Jesus Christ on the cross for your sins, was promised to God's people, but it's so much greater even than they could have understood. Notice they were searching and they were inquiring carefully. They were looking intently for this promised salvation. They had hope that it was coming, and the promise of a Messiah, of a payment for their sins, was promised for hundreds of years before, and they only knew glimpses of the glory that was to be in Jesus Christ, but they were awaiting it eagerly. Jesus' suffering and his glory were prophesied in so many places throughout Scripture. One of those that we know about frequently is Isaiah 53, where it talks about the fact that he was pierced for our transgressions, that he was crushed for our iniquity, and by his wounds we were healed. That through his suffering and his glorification, that we receive that glory with him. And this is just one passage of many, many throughout the Old Testament. There are tons, and that's not even mentioning the beautiful redemption story that God writes all through the Old Testament. Through saints like Abraham and Joseph and Moses and Esther and Jonah and David and on, countless people who God was writing a story of his redemption, of the promise of salvation that's found in Jesus Christ, and none of them saw it. None of them saw what you and I have seen and what we have experienced and what we know about. And while they all waited for hope, we should look back with remembrance and with joy. We can look back at what was promised to them that they didn't see and now is here in Jesus Christ, that we can rejoice in that and we can have a secure hope as we remember those things and then look towards the future. Because a lot of things in our lives, we look at and sort of groan about them, but people hundreds of years ago would have blown their minds to get what you and I have. One of the times that I was traveling, I was on a plane and they came over the intercom and said, you know, we're very sorry, we tried to work on it, but for the flight today, the Wi-Fi is going to be down. And the whole plane was like, oh, like this collective groan. And I just had a moment, I'm like, so wait a minute. Let me get this straight. The fact that you are in a tin can flying through the air. Last time I checked, humans were not really made to fly. But we're in a can flying through the air at 700 miles an hour. Taking a trip that people hundreds of years ago, it would have just blown their mind that we could go that far, that fast, and we're complaining that the Wi-Fi isn't working? This is ridiculous. Don't allow the difficulties in life to overshadow the gratitude and the love for God, for the salvation that he's provided for you and I in Jesus Christ. The things that we have should drive us to gratitude in the Lord. The things that we have now should stir our affections for God so that we love him more. Do they for you? When you look at what God has provided for you in salvation in Jesus Christ, does it stir your heart to love him more? When you look at all that the Lord has done for you, does it cause you to love him more, or are you just complaining that the Wi-Fi is down? When you remember that the salvation that you received in Jesus Christ, it was promised long ago to a people who never saw any of it. They never saw the beauty of it, but you do. Does that cause you to love him more? When you think back and you remember where you were in your sin before you met Jesus Christ, before coming to him, does it cause you to love him more? When you remember all of the ways that he's changed you, he's made you into a new creation and continues to do that in his faithfulness, do you love him more? Because the difference between cranky, entitled people and joyful, loving people is this. It's remembrance. It's a gratitude and a love for God because of what he's done already for me in my life. No matter what happens in my life, no matter the joys or the heartaches, whatever shows up on my doorstep, I can worship him because my hope is secure. It is a living hope, an inheritance awaiting me in heaven, that my salvation is bought and it's sealed and it's kept for me in heaven, no matter what. So as we go about this goofy, strange land as strangers in it, don't forget our home. Don't forget the secure living hope that you have. Remember what God has promised in the past and what he's brought you through and what he's brought his people through. Remember what God has promised in our eternal home and all that's awaiting us in Jesus Christ, and allow that salvation that we've already experienced and we are yet to receive as an inheritance, allow that remembrance to fuel your rejoicing and your worship of a perfect Savior. Father, we are grateful for what you have accomplished in us through Jesus Christ. It is abundantly more than we could ever ask or imagine. And God, we would pray that you would allow us to see with eyes towards eternity the secure living hope that you've accomplished for us in Jesus Christ. That we would see that as secure. We would see that as greater than any of our trials. And we would see that as something that has been promised of old and fulfilled before our eyes as we see it unfold. Allow us to worship you in increasing ways because of all that you've done and all that you're yet to do. We pray in Jesus' name.